Hi everyone, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this lecture I'll discuss the phenomenon of the Internet of Things, starting with a discussion of networked objects and all that this emergent phenomenon portends, and trying to analyze what are the effects of the Internet of Things as a phenomenon, as an emergent Internet paradigm. On objects and materiality itself, on spaces which we inhabit. The lecture is divided into four parts. I will start, as is customary, with a discussion linking the lecture to the remaining cycle of lectures on future networks. And then we'll jump into the Internet of Things as a concept, as a phenomenon, trying to understand how it all works together conceptually. And then we'll explore what I term as sociable objects and anticipatory spaces. As a caveat, before I begin, the Internet of Things is an emergent paradigm, and it has vast implications, which span from purely technological to economic, social, political. It has implications in terms of privacy, in terms of surveillance, in terms of new materials, an entirely new sensory apparatus, in terms of literally new types of clothing even. And so it cannot be really explored in detail in one lecture. So what I've opted to do here is to try and focus on the specific implications when it comes to the changing role of objects in how we perceive and act in the world, and also the changing role of spaces. And I've organized the lecture in a conceptual way so that you can get a clearer perspective of what is at stake and what is unfolding, rather than focusing on specific technologies or specific case studies, which may or may not be valid, let's say 5 years or 10 years down the track. All right, so let's begin with retracing our steps a little bit and trying to link the Internet of Things to all these other phenomena we've already discussed in this cycle of lectures. So as an opener, I'm going back to the very beginning, to the first lecture in which we talked about the telegraph. And here we have literally the opener of that lecture, in which Nathaniel Hawthorne in The House of Seven Gables exclaims to one of his characters, "The world of matter has become a great nerve, vibrating thousands of miles in a breathless point of time." And of course, what he's talking about here is the emergence of the telegraph, the emergence of information networks spanning the globe, and by that very fact, rearranging the rules of occupancy of that world, rearranging materiality itself, rearranging matter, rearranging how we conduct ourselves, how our being unfolds in the world, and rearranging time itself, right? So we've talked about this from the perspective of the emergence of the global information network, first in the guise of the telegraph, and then through various different evolutionary changes to what we now call the internet. But this is the very essence here of that a profound shift that our ancestors first experienced in the middle of the 19th century with the arrival of the telegraph and the rearranging of the rules of occupancy of this world, if you will. Right? So a great nerve. So the world of matter has become a great nerve, vibrating thousands of miles in a breathless point of time. So let's return back to this again and again for the remainder of the lecture, because it is that very same impulse, that very same essential shift that is still unfolding, the shift to which Nathaniel Hawthorne reacted in his poetic way. And here we have a scientific American from the end of the 19th century exclaiming and pointing at the same phenomenon, right? when the time is close at hand, when the scattered members of civilized communities will be as closely united, so far as instant telephonic communication is concerned, as the various members of the body now are by the nervous system. So we have this notion of the unification of space and of beings in space globally, as the various members of the body are by the nervous system. So you have a global nervous system, right? And we've talked about this in the context of the network society paradigm. The key thing here, though, is that this extension of the network has not stopped, right? So it started with the telegraph and it has not abated. If anything, it has sped up dramatically with the arrival of the internet, and specifically with the arrival of mobile internet, of mobile connectivity. And we will return to that in a moment. So we have a continuous process of integration of materiality into the network. This is that key essential shift that I want to focus your attention on, because this is what is at the very basis of the emergence of the Internet of Things. So we have the arrival of the network society as a paradigm. So the social structure is rearranged completely around information networks. It's literally made of them. It is a global bioelectronic environment involving both our bodies and our lived spaces and the information network. So this should be viewed, these two phenomena, right, in the context of the network society paradigm, should be viewed as the building blocks of what is now unfolding, which is the Internet of Things, the next stage of the enlargement of the network and the integration of a variety of objects and material elements into the network itself as active participants. We talked also about the new economy which emerges with the network society paradigm, and for which information and knowledge is the primary value proposition. So the primary vector for valorization, for extracting value, is in connecting to and sorting information. And again, when you think of the Internet of Things, you should be thinking in this context of adding new sources of information to the network, right? And the conversion of physical materiality into information for the purposes of the network. We also talked about the purely human level aspects of the network society paradigm in the context of a liquid life and liquid labor. So for the purposes of this lecture, what's crucial here is this notion of personal information spaces. Because we by nature of being humans, we tend to think anthropocentrically, putting ourselves in the middle when it comes to a phenomenon such as the global information network, which is not, from the perspective of the network, which this is not the case, right? Personal information spaces can be associated with any set of objects and thought of in the context of any type or category of materiality. Same thing applies to presence bleed, right? We think of presence bleed in the context of our own physical presence in a space and time, and it's bleeding through in the network, and we talked about this in our discussion of liquid life. But the key thing here is that presence bleed applies equally as well to any type of object, right? So if you think of presence bleed in the context of your own experiences of being in a space and time while also being on the network and your attention being divided, so you're physically somewhere but your thoughts and your attention is on the network somewhere else entirely, so you're both there and not there, hence presence bleed. The same thing applies to objects, right, which are connected to the internet, which are connected and to a network, and we'll talk more about this in a second. We also talked about the emergence of the stacks, right, these vertically integrated walled gardens which are built around the aggregation and leveraging of user information, right? Literally the aggregation and leveraging of behavioral data for predictive purposes on behavioral futures markets. So when you're thinking down the track in this lecture about the Internet of Things, you should always already think in terms of how the stacks are positioned here, right? So all the devices we discuss down the track should be viewed in the context of the stack. So think in terms of how all of this data that is being collected is always already part and parcel of some cloud server farm somewhere. It's part of a specific mobile ecology belonging to a specific stack. The data that is being generated by the existence of this object in a specific space and time, the behavioral, the predictive data automatically becomes the product of that specific stack. The rendering of space as raw material for behavioral and predictive data, and the role again of futures markets. And finally, we have the notion of dark fiber, right? So this is both the criminal underground online and cyber warfare should be viewed in the context of the Internet of Things. So think in terms of vulnerabilities, which scale exponentially, right? With the massive increase of connected objects, which are poorly, if at all, secured when it comes to access. So think in terms of every possible system being attacked by state and non-state actors, and actors leveraging their access to this data flow. And this notion of every device being a target for colonization. So what, think in terms of when you think about the Internet of Things systemically, what emerges in the context of dark fiber? What emerges in the context of the leveraging of these devices for cyber warfare and for all sorts of exploits, the leveraging of these data flows for all sorts of different predictive capabilities. All right, so this sets the stage as it was. So now let's dive into the Internet of Things and try and understand what the Internet of Things actually involves. And my starting point is this famous dictum by technologist and thinker Russell Davis, framed the Internet of Things in the context of a teddy bear. So I can't understand why teddy bears did not have Wi-Fi before. A bear without Wi-Fi is barely alive. A semi-bear. So of course, obviously, this is designed to be provocative and to, you know, to generate laughter and a smile. But there is a very deep insight behind what Russell Davis is pointing at here. And the insight is that if an object can be connected, for whatever trivial reason, it will be connected to the internet through a Wi-Fi, as the example of this teddy bear, or through Bluetooth or whatever other connection technology, right? Why would it be connected? And the answer is, the question is actually wrongly posed, because as he points out, a bear without Wi-Fi is barely alive, a semi-bear. So the answer to why would an object be connected to the internet, right, is that if connecting it to the internet would give it some new capabilities, then you have to count on the fact that at some point or other, this type of objects, this class of objects will be connected, right? So if 10 years ago someone told you that all cars will be connected to the internet, this would sound unbelievable, but now the question already stops making sense, right? Why would you connect your car to the internet? Now, most new cars, if not all, are always already with some sort of internet connectivity enabled. The really new, dramatically new cars, like for example, electric cars, etc., they come out with always on internet connectivity. So think in terms of everyday devices, think in terms of clothing, think in terms of random objects encountered in spaces, you know, in shopping malls, etc. We're looking at a dramatic reweaving of materiality here. And at any point when you ask yourself, why would someone connect this or that to the internet, think back to the Russell Davis quip, right? So what would happen if you add Wi-Fi to a teddy bear? You know, you can build all sorts of new and interesting capabilities when it comes to that teddy bear. So again, what is the Internet of Things? And the term was invented in 1999. It was coined by Kevin Ashton, a theorist who was working at the MIT Media Lab at the time. And the context here is serious conceptual work in terms of trying to understand the evolutionary vector of the internet. So where is the internet going to next? And the key thing to understand here is that Kevin Ashton saw in the developmental trajectory of the internet an inevitable expansion into the trivial everyday, right? So first you start with having centralized mainframe computers connected to each other, right? That's the first steps of the internet. Then you expand to personal computers, where suddenly there is a computer in every home and hundreds of computers in offices everywhere, right? Then you expand to smartphones. So now there is not only a computer in every home, but there is a computer in every pocket, in every bag, right? And often more than one. And then the next stage that follows that is other devices, other objects that potentially could be easily connected to the internet. So that could potentially be integrated into the network, gaining that capability. And so this is the next stage of the evolutionary development of the internet, and Kevin Ashton termed it as the Internet of Things. So on a very basic level, it stands for literally physical objects connecting to the internet, and it involves a set of capabilities that is quite simple, but is poorly understood to this day by people, and most definitely the systemic effects of those capabilities are poorly understood. So let's try and unpack them a little bit, because it's crucial to understand what these capabilities actually mean in practice systemically in order to follow through with where we're going next in this lecture. So an object connected to the Internet of Things has to have first and foremost, a unique network ID. And this is non-negotiable because it has to be able to be recognized by the network as a unique node. And in order to be a unique node, it has to have a unique, what is called MAC address. So it has to have a unique address on the network. So each and every object connected to the internet that you can think of has a unique network ID that makes it identifiable on the network as a node. Second, the object connected to the Internet of Things has to have some sort of sensor that gives it a data interface to the materiality that surrounds it. So this sensor can be anything from a motion sensor to voice to video to smell to movement. And everything in between and even more than we can think of at this point. The point is that it has to have some sort of interface which allows it to extract data and information from its environment. It has to have storage and processing capabilities. They can be very advanced, or it can be very primitive. The point is that it has to be able to store this data and then process it and transmit it on the network. It has to have some sort of actuation, which allows it to act based on some sort of programs to display something or to voice something or to react to specific changes in its environment. It allows, by virtue of the fact that it's connected to the network, it allows remote access to its specific locale and to itself. And more often than not, it would have some sort of semantic interface allowing humans to interact with it, right? Allowing humans to engage with its data and its storage and processing powers. So let's try and unpack this a little bit more. So each object has a network address, making it uniquely identifiable. This means in practice that each and every object that you encounter online, each and every Internet of Things objects that you encounter in a face-to-face situation, so this can be anything from internet-connected fridge or toaster or whatever, is uniquely identifiable on the global internet. It has the exact same internet address that your smartphone has, right? Or that you yourself would have if you have your own server online. It has sensors allowing it to dynamically register changes to its environment. So this means that at any one point, the environment in which this object is immersed is being translated into data that is shared on the network. So think of it in these terms. An environment that until now was invisible to the network, because remember, the global information network is always already a binary state, right? So you're either on or you're off, and if you're off, you're invisible to the network. You have no interface, no data informational interface allowing information to from that specific locale or from you to flow on the network. And it's the same thing here. So from the perspective of the network, an object which has not been connected, which doesn't have any sensors, a teddy bear without Wi-Fi, in other words, is somehow degraded, right? Because it cannot participate, it cannot share information, it is not part of the processing and sorting of information flows, right? You remember, this is the primary value proposition when it comes to the global information network. So an object without sensors is a mute and dumb object from the perspective of the global information network. And conversely, an object with sensors has that capability and it automatically can dynamically register changes to its environment and participate in the network in one way or another. An object participating on the Internet of Things also has the ability to store and process information. And crucially, this means that it is able to, in one way or another, extract data from its environment, as we already established when we talked about sensors, but also it can process that information share it with the global information network, share it with a cloud, maybe, if this is part of some sort of cloud ecology. So if this object is part of, let's say, some sort of stack, then it automatically shares that information with the stack, right? And is able to react based on the information which returns to it from the stack. Now, this is really important because the object can initiate action locally, right? So if this action can be something as simple as a thermostat which is connected to the Internet of Things, automatically switching the temperature or switching the air conditioning in the room off if there's a certain temperature achieved in the room. So that's the simplest possible actuation. But it could automatically also be switched off remotely, maybe by you, right? Based on access through the cloud. Or it could automatically be switched off from the cloud based on whatever algorithm is in the cloud that allows the object to be switched off remotely or to initiate action remotely. And this brings me to the obvious next point, that if the object is on the internet, it means that it can be remotely located. It can be remotely engaged with through the network. And remotely here stands for remotely from the perspective of its physical environment, right? So an object might be in some sort of physical location, let's say in your living room, but it is always already experiencing presence bleed because it's on the network, right? So it can be remotely located on the network, but simultaneously remotely located in your physical environment, right? And we will give some examples in a second so you can understand how this all fits together. So we're looking here at a situation where an object is bought online and in some sort of physical space, but its online interface, the fact that it is part of the Internet of Things, part of the Internet, trumps its physical location because of the aggregate power of the online flows of information that it can leverage because it's part of the an online ecology. And we will return to this again. Finally, an object on the Internet of Things may have a semantic interface for humans. I say may have because there are a number of different objects which are on the internet but do not have an interface which makes them legible to humans because they don't need it. This is the so-called M2M internet or machine-to-machine internet, where objects, they are usually some sort of sensors, located online, but their interfacing is only with other objects which are also online. The interfacing is not directly with humans, hence they do not have a semantic interface for humans. However, there are a range of objects with some sort of semantic interface which can be accessed either directly from the object, so for example think of objects that react to your voice, or through some sort of other device, let's say through your smartphone, where you can access the capabilities of an object or access its data flow or access its storage or any other aspect of that specific Internet of Things located object through a semantic interface provided by your smartphone. So this gives us a systemic perspective of the kind of new object that emerges with the Internet of Things. It has a unique network ID, it has some sort of sensor, it has storage and processing power, has the ability to actuate action, it has allows remote access to a specific locale, and it has some sort of semantic interface more often than not for humans. So let's look at some examples. Here is a typical example from this year, 2020, of an Internet of Things related object. So we have the Amazon Echo. You can put other similar devices in the same category, such as, for example, Google Home. So when you think of the Amazon Echo, you're automatically thinking of an object connected to the internet. So it has a unique network ID. It has storage capacity. It has processing power. It has sensory apparatus. It can detect your voice and reacts to your voice. And when connected with other devices, it's able to gain even more sensory apparatus. For example, it can connect to a thermostat or through a door camera and to a number of other devices in the home. It has the ability to actuate remotely. It has it gives remote access to the space, and it has a semantic interface for humans. Another such example is your classical smart fridge example, and I've shown you here one type from one company, but there's a number of them. And again, the point is that this is the exact same type of object. And these are just entry-level objects from a very early stage of the development of the Internet of Things. Another type is a car, right? So here we have the Tesla Model S, which is an electric car, which is first and foremost a computer connected to the Internet of Things. And second, a car with a battery and wheels and the ability to drive on the road, right? So a Tesla is continuously connected to the internet, continuously streams information, exchanges information with the internet, and it's the exact same type of Internet of Things connected object that we've described already with the Amazon Echo, for example. Another example, your typical Fitbit, which again fits all of these categories. It has a semantic interface, it is connected to the internet, etc., etc., etc. So all of these categories of objects always already part of this nascent, emergent new evolutionary stage of the internet, the Internet of Things. So they all have a unique network ID, they all have some sort of sensor, to detect and extract information from the environment. All of them have the ability to store and process information. They all actuate based on some sort of command, either local or remote. They all allow remote access to the environment, and they all have a semantic interface for humans, right? So you have now hopefully a clearer systemic perspective of the kind of object that can be involved online as part of the Internet of Things. And this is only not even scratching the surface. This is the most basic introduction, because when it comes to the Internet of Things, you should be thinking of each and every type of object surrounding you. So you can think of tables, chairs, items of clothing, shoes, random objects on the street, benches, umbrellas, etc., etc., being connected to the internet. And again, if at some point by just looking around and thinking how can something be connected to the internet, you react with why would you connect this specific whatever object to the internet, think immediately of Russell Davis's dictum and the teddy bear and the Wi-Fi, right? Why would you connect a fridge or a toaster or a washing machine to the internet, right? So I'll let you answer this for yourself. The key thing to add here when it comes to this systemic perspective of how an Internet of Things related object actually would look like is to understand that, again, when you have all of these characteristics, all of these capabilities in aggregate, working systemically together as part of a whole of this new type of object, what emerges is, first and foremost, an object which is what is termed in the industry as context aware, which stands for, context is understood here in a very specific way. It's understood as the triad of location, identity, state. So we have an object which is at all times aware of its location, so where exactly it is, its identity, in terms of what this object is specifically. So here we have the role of the network ID. And its state, right? So its state can be a very simple stream of data, or it can be an extremely complex stream of data composed of a number of different sensory data inputs combined together to form the state. So a context-aware object can be potentially an object with gathering a tremendous amount of information about its environment, about its location, about its identity and its context, the context of that identity, the relation of that identity to other objects in its vicinity, and its state, right, expressed through the tremendous sensory data flows that it could potentially be gathering. And there is a really important fine point here that it's important that everyone listening to this understands. As humans, we have this constant temptation to think in an anthropocentric way of surrounding reality. So we position ourselves in the center and we imagine that the only point of view available is the point of view that we have on the surrounding reality and on objects. But if you shift away from this perspective and you look at an Internet of Things enabled object from, let's say, the perspective of a database, or from the perspective of the global information of the internet itself on which the object resides, then a completely new picture emerges, a dramatically different picture of the status of being of this object. Because from a cloud database perspective, and we already established that all objects connected to the Internet of Things have some sort of cloud exposure, some sort of connectivity with data flows online. So from a cloud database perspective, from the perspective of the internet, that contextual data that an Internet of Things object gathers from moment to moment is the object, right? The object literally is that data. The object is not some sort of physical instantaneity that you are encountering and touching as a human, right? From the perspective of the internet, that perspective of ours, the human perspective, is meaningless, right? Literally, it is meaningless. It does not compute. It does not register. Why? Because it's not explained as data. And the moment it is expressed as data in terms of, let's say, tactile information that the object gathers, let's say someone touched it, So the object gathers this sensory data as part of its context data. And the moment that is added to the sensorium of the object, it starts making sense to the internet. But it's always already filtered as data first and physical reality second. This is really important to understand, right? So from the perspective of the network, from the perspective of a cloud database, for example, the object is context data, first and foremost. This is its primary state. Its physical state is secondary. And this is valid for each and every object, each and every aspect of reality connected to the internet, right? From the perspective of the internet, the only type of being is a data being, a being which registers as data, as information. Right? Everything else literally does not exist. If it exists for the internet, it means it's expressed in one or another as data. And Boosterling explains this very nicely in his book Shaping Things, which is a fantastic book on it's a conceptual imagining of the implications of the Internet of Things. I highly recommend it. The Internet of Things object is a set of relationships first and always, and an object now and then, right? So first and always, it is a set of data dependencies, data relationships, and a physical instantiation of some sort of materiality now and then, right? It's the physical aspect is optional. The data is non-negotiable, right? If there is no data, if there is no information interface, that object does not exist from the perspective of the internet. It's not part of any reality. So far, so good. So if you've been able to follow so far, and if everything made sense, then the next realization should come as no surprise, right? From the perspective of the internet, a human body exists only as a data stream. And absent that data stream, it literally does not register. There's no aspect of it that can be registered as existing. So the first building block of this emergent paradigm of the Internet of Things is that the human bodies wearing Fitbit watches, for example, register online first and foremost, and only in fact, as a heartbeat, some sort of electrical impulse that can be interpreted, as blood pressure, etc., etc., etc. Right. So there is a set of data points that are interpreted by the internet, by the specific database, cloud database in the case of Fitbit, as some sort of meaning generating. Information flow, but the rest of the body, its physicality as such, does not register, right? The human itself as a concept registers only in terms of the contextual data it generates for the internet, and this does not differentiate it in any way from the other objects which generate similar data. So this is the crucial thing to understand when it comes to the emergent Internet of Things paradigm. So every object connected to the internet and forming that emergent paradigm is submitting some sort of contextual data flow continuously, and it generates through that flow, it generates what we can call very broadly digital history. So this digital history allows that objects to appear in a, you could visualize it in a 3D state in space and time in terms of context, logistics and use patterns. So it can be mapped in terms of its local context, its logistics, so how it is performing itself in existence from moment to moment, and in terms of its use patterns, if this is some sort of object that is supposed to be used for whatever purposes, the patterns of its usage are also emerging as part of its digital history. And now, this sounds very complex, but it's a really important point to understand, because what emerges in effect is a data shadow which is associated with each and every object part of the Internet of Things. So that's it's and from a perspective of the Internet, of the network, it is data shadow that is the real object. It is not the material aspect of the object that it's its realness. It's the data shadow itself, right? We already established that. And so, in effect, we have the emergence of an ecology, right? So imagine the Internet of Things as an emergent ecology of objects, where objects continuously, relentlessly self-disclose their contexts, right? So they translate their context, so that you think of the location of a specific object, think of the location of, let's say, a toaster in your kitchen or of your fridge, or of a smart home device such as, you know, Google Home, for example. So they continuously translate the contextual data, which they gather through the sensory apparatus, and they self-disclose it relentlessly online. All right, so this data has to be self-disclosed, otherwise the object itself stops being a part of the Internet of Things, right? So in effect, you have that data shadow that we already explained earlier is being continuously populated with new information. It's continuously made more and more real, right? By virtue of the information that is being gathered continuously. Right, so this information is extracted from materiality. And in effect, what we're observing is, as part of the Internet of Things paradigm, is this is a shift in the role physical objects play in space and in their interactions with humans, right? Because suddenly they are armed with that data shadow, which was not there before. And that's a disruptive shift. That's, I've described it as a disruptive shift, because it suddenly repositions how objects are seen by us in the role of these objects in terms of their surrounding spaces and in terms of their relationships with humans. Suddenly, objects have agency, right? Which is made specifically and particularly potent by our encounters with their data shadow, which is continuously being accumulated. So what we have in effect is the emergent characteristics of the Internet of Things paradigm is the following. So we already established objects are connecting to the internet. They become context aware, so they gather continuous data flows about their location, identity, and state. It's this triad of location, identity, state which forms a context. So that's why we can say an object is context aware, because it gathers information about its location, identity, and state continuously. They self-disclose this contextual information relentlessly online to some sort of database, to some sort of cloud. From the perspective of the cloud to which they self-disclose, this context data that is being disclosed is the object, actually, right? So this is that this data shadow that is being formed, that is cast in effect by the object, is what, from the perspective of the internet, constitutes the object itself. It's not the material, whatever it is. It allows, so this object that is casting a data shadow allows the precise mapping of its material environment, of its material context, of its logistics of use, and the patterns of its use. And because of this role of the data shadow and the way the internet sees reality, right, from the perspective of the internet, reality is explained only as data shadows, only as information data flows. All materiality that is captured, registered in this way, including humans, including the human body itself, right, is primary data from the perspective of the Internet of Things, right? So the Internet of Things sees the human body as data to be harvested, processed, leveraged in one way or another. All right, so that being said, we've sort of mapped the conceptual framework that forms the Internet of Things. Now let's dive into this the effects on objects and on the way we perceive objects of this shift into the Internet of Things. So the way I framed this problem is sociable objects, because the argument that I'm trying to make here is that the Internet of Things causes objects to dramatically shift in the way we perceive them and in the way they're positioned in their interactions with the surrounding environment and with humans, into some sort of change of agency, which makes them appear as sociable. And this is really complex to explain to words, but it's very easily illustrated in this sort of comics, like this one from John Klosner. So we have to go out for dinner, the refrigerator isn't speaking to the stove. This is a classic Internet of Things moment, right? Why? Because you have two different objects which, for whatever reason, have not been able to exchange information. Notice how what I said earlier, that objects may have semantic interfaces for humans, and in this case, both the refrigerator and the stove clearly have a semantic interfaces for humans, but they have not been able to link up their own interfaces for whatever reason, doesn't really matter. And the effect here is that suddenly the human interlocutors, like the human owners of these objects, or the human users, to use a better term, of these objects, suddenly are out of the loop, right? So they cannot use the refrigerator and the stove because you know the refrigerator and the stove are in a heated argument with each other, right? So notice how the entire relationship of a human with the surrounding environment, in this case, you know, the kitchen, has been reframed here. There's a dramatic shift in agencies, right? Suddenly, humans are not the center of all relationships. So this is not an anthropocentric scenario anymore. This is a scenario in which humans are on the same flat plane of being, the same flat ontological plane, as all of these other objects, which are also connected to the internet. So again, objects are connected to the internet, they're context aware, they self-disclose context relentlessly. From the perspective of the internet, context data is the object. It allows precise mapping of the space, logistics, and patterns. And everyday materiality, human body materiality as well, is data. So, knowing all of this and having that cartoon in mind, here is a question. What distinguishes the Twitter feed of a human from that of an Internet of Things object tweeting its status? Keep in mind that the Twitter feed here is a semantic interface for humans, right? So it's a simplified example, because the real question here is what distinguishes the data feed of a human from that of an object, right? Because from the perspective of a database, from the perspective of the internet, the data feed of a human is literally identical as that of any random object. Both data feeds are simply translating context, location, identity, state, continuously, right? Presumably if they're both connected to the internet. So here is a simple, the question simplifies this, because Twitter itself is a human interface, right? But if Internet of Things connected object is tweeting its status, so it's tweeting its context, right? Location, identity, state, in a way framed for humans, right? Through words or images or whatever, nothing distinguishes it from the Twitter feed of a human, right? Both are always already simply data. And this is, again, really important to understand, because it illustrates that flattening where objects suddenly have the same instrumentarium as humans to express agency. And therefore, from the perspective of humans now, objects appear as if they've gained the power to be social, as if they've gained the entire social apparatus which was until now available only to humans. And this is what I mean when I talk about sociable objects. They, in effect, become tangibly sociable, right? So they appear as if they're socializing, as if they're engaging in some sort of social interactions with us and with each other. Hence, the fridge is upset at the stove and they're not talking to each other, right? So when we have to eat outside for the night. So I explained this in an article on the Internet of Things focusing on this problem specifically in the following way. When mundane everyday objects or their virtual equivalents acquire actuator status, or when they acquire the ability to initiate action as objects on the Internet of Things, they become tangible social actors. And from the perspective of their information imprint, indistinguishable from humans. Right? They are literally gaining the same social status as a human. The sociable object has the ability to explicitly collect, discard, locate, measure, transmit, alter, and store information. In other words, the sociable object is inextricably entangled in the semantic world of humans, with all the implied ontological uncertainty as to the agential origins of entities. In other words, the moment an object joins the Internet of Things and starts manipulating data, changing data, transmitting data, collecting and discarding it, etc., and starts signaling through some sort of semantic interface to humans and to other objects, it automatically transgresses its ontological status, so it automatically transgresses its status as a simple, trivial, mute and dull material object. It becomes something else. It becomes a sociable object, right? It enters the semantic world of humans as a social actor, able to affect humans in a variety of ways. And so the more these objects start emerging and joining our lives, the more we all are going to be experiencing this clash with objects which heretofore were passive and dull and we would not even pay them any attention to active social actors in our daily lives, in our daily routines. And again, you know, we have this notion of, you know, the trivial object acting out. Right? This is what the very definition of a sociable object is. The toaster has been hacked and it's thinking it's a blender. Right? So the toaster suddenly has its own mind, right? Which does not follow an anthropocentric definition of the world. Right? Our anthropocentric definition of the world presupposes that we are the only subjects in this reality. Right? We are the only actors. Everything else is simply a subject, is simply an object to our actions. Right? It's a receptacle to our agency. But something changes dramatically, right, when you have these objects emerging with their own data shadow, which is potentiated by cloud computing and big data and predictive algorithms, etc., etc. Suddenly, these objects emerge as profoundly transgressive, right? They transgress these roles we've assigned to them. Suddenly they're able to appear sociable. And this is what's at stake here with this notion of sociable objects. And to compound the issue here, to compound that transgressive nature of the Internet of Things, you have this ability of IoT objects to dispense with humans as intermediaries, right? Again, you know, the stove and the fridge are not on talking terms today. So when such objects are in each other's interaction range, they are a priori expected to socialize with one another, exchanging data. Right? So notice how profoundly this alters the relationship between objects and a human subject. How profoundly this alters the agentorial status of humans, because suddenly you have two different objects, heretofore dull and mute and trivial, talking to each other, engaging in a social interaction with each other, right? Outside of any sort of interfacing with the human, right? This is what's so disruptive here. And you know, we can only satirize this again, and that's the other really disruptive thing here, is that we can only think of these phenomena from the perspective of human social characteristics, or from a perspective of human social experiences, right? So the kettle and the toaster in love, right? They met on the Internet of Things. Again, this is dictated by the fact that our perspective of reality is firmly rooted in an anthropocentric point of view, whereas you have this dramatic reordering of reality coming with the Internet of Things. So suddenly we are appearing on the same flat plane as all of these other objects from the perspective of the Internet. I repeat this again. We all appear as simply data streams, right? So you have two different data streams entangled with each other and engaging in some sort of intensive information exchange, right? So they are in love, right? So this is it's a profoundly non-human perspective on reality. This is what I'm pointing at. And to be clear, right, it's really important that everyone understands this. As I've pointed out, this is an environment where all sorts of objects, you know, cars, fridges, coffee cups, toasters, form a contextually rich conversation. And again, contextually rich because location, identity, state, with no human interference or presence, right? So objects are exchanging that information with no human acting as a mediator between them, no human injecting their agency in the objects. So what's happening here is a very strange, weird environment emerging in which human and non-human agencies are very thickly intertwined. And from the perspective of humans, these non-human agencies engaging with each other are completely alien. Like, we cannot engage with them in any way unless there is some sort of semantic interface explaining them to us in a language which our senses can understand. So this should put more light on this cartoon, right? This realization of that we're witnessing the emergence of sociable objects, a completely new type of object, a completely new type of materiality. You know, the refrigerator isn't speaking to the stove, right? So they're engaged in some sort of social interaction which is completely impenetrable to us. So again, to summarize, we're witnessing a transition with the arrival of the Internet of Things. We have a transition of objects from a trivial materiality with which we are familiar. It's the only materiality we know, in fact, to sociable materiality, which transgresses these subject-object boundaries that we are inscribing on the world traditionally. And this sociable materiality appears as dynamic contextual data in computational environments, right? So from the perspective of the internet, of the network society paradigm, right? From the perspective of cyberspace, which we described as a bioelectronic environment, if you recall, suddenly objects and humans appear as dynamic contextual data, right? On the same plane. So the only thing that differentiates the data streams is the identities of the different emitters of data, the generators of these data shadows. But there is no human, non-human difference between them, right? This is a difference that appears as some sort of legacy human difference inscribed on this newly emergent world by humans, which are always already in the minority. So we have, again, the Internet of Things paradigm that we mapped, and to everything else we already mapped, we're adding one more element, that everyday objects become sociable, right? They transgress the boundaries of agency imposed to them by humans. All right, so having mapped sociable objects, now let's jump into this notion of anticipatory spaces. So we understand what the Internet of Things is conceptually. We mapped how this newly emergent paradigm actually works and its key constituent elements, we described that shift in terms of objects themselves, and we described them as sociable objects, in effect, because they transgress the boundaries of agency inscribed on them by humans. And now we're trying to understand the effect of this on lived materiality itself, on spaces, and unpack this notion of the anticipatory space. So let's start with the already sort of firmly established imaginary of what is described variously as the smart home or the Internet of Things enabled home. So what we're having here is an environment, lived space, I underscore, which is constituent of various Internet of Things connected objects, which work together as part of a mutually coherent system. So these objects talk to each other in a coherent way, where they can understand each other. So the fridge and the stove talk to each other, and they're friends with the garage, and they are on cordial relationships with the solar batteries on top and the washing machine, right? So you have these all sorts of different elements in that lived space, in that lived environment as the home, or you could extend this to the city, for example, or the street for that matter, being able to talk to each other outside of the necessity to communicate with a human and to transmit continuously contextual data to their data shadows online, to the cloud. And on top of that, each of these elements, in one way or another, has a semantic interface allowing them to communicate with humans. Right? Humans here being the primary agents, let's frame it this way, which around which this space has been configured, right, for the comfort of humans. But from, again, I underscore, from the perspective of the network, all of these elements and the humans in the middle, in that house, are simply a range of different data streams, which are differentiated only by their network IDs. So we have the picture of the smart home. And the key question with the emergence of this sort of spaces, and there's more and more of them, there's many suburban houses nowadays would have the beginnings of a smart home situation. They would have either Amazon Echo or Google Home. They would have some sort of other elements, let's say a front door camera or lights or thermostat or whatever, controlled by Google Home or Amazon Echo. The point is that this picture is not a fictional scenario anymore, right? It's already real. So the key question, as framed by Julian Blicker in his famous manifesto for networked objects, Why Things Matter, is when it is not only us, but also our things that can upload, download, disseminate, and stream meaningful and meaning-making stuff. How does the way in which we occupy the physical world become different? Right, so what changes in how we think about and act within the physical world? What changes in space, in our conceptualization of space, right, of materiality as such? How do they differ? How do they change? And the starting point for an answer to this question is, again, coming from this notion of the data shadow. So in this cartoon, what we have here is the Amazon Echo acting as primary subject in an interaction with the human, right? Primary subject in the sense that agency originates from the Echo, not from the human. The human is on the receiving end of that agency. But this captures, this brilliant capture of the transgressive reorientation of agencies and the subsequent change in spatial relationships. Right? Martin, I decided your life was empty and meaningless, so I ordered you a bouncy castle and 3 bottles of vodka. So what happens here is you have that that data shadow, which you know, the Amazon Echo is building on the human being used to act back within that space, which is inhabited by that human, by the Martin from the picture, right? So the data shadow, which is invisible to the human, these data shadows are invisible to us unless there is some sort of semantic interface translating them into a language which we can understand. But these data shadows, as I already pointed out several times, are how the internet sees the world, actually, right? So the human, from the perspective of the internet, is this data shadow and nothing else. It does not exist outside of it, right? So from the perspective of that data shadow, this human appears in this specific way, right? So this data shadow acts on the world while we cannot see it. Therefore, changing radically the experience of space in which that data shadow exists, right? Let's unpack this even further, because it's a really complex point. So we have objects acquiring network connectivity, storage, computation powers, like their Internet of Things objects. They automatically transgress the borders we have assigned to them, right? So they are automatically changing their status. They become sociable objects. And crucially here, these to understand what is at stake here, you need to remember that these objects do not exist in isolation, right? They are part of a complex system involving the cloud, involving a data shadow, involving the network, involving information flows, and their physical space, which is constantly, always already in a sense of presence bleed. So we talked about that, personal information spaces and presence bleed. So, in effect, you have spaces which are continuously in a state of presence bleed, leaking information through the sensory apparatus of the Internet of Things object into a data shadow, which is somewhere in the cloud. Or as Julian Blicker frames it, once things are connected to the internet, they can only but become enrolled as active worldly participants by knitting together, facilitating, and contributing to networks of social exchange and discourse, and rearranging the rules of occupancy and patterns of mobility within the physical world. So this is what is at stake here. It's the rules of occupancy and patterns of mobility within the physical world. The relationships within the space itself are reconfigured. Dramatically transgressed by the appearance of an Internet of Things object in that space. So, another example illustrating this, and again, these are examples which should illustrate to you conceptually what is at stake, but also remember that the devices here, in this case, these are all Amazon Echo devices, these are from the perspective of the evolutionary trajectory of the Internet, these are only the beginning, right? So these are the equivalents of the telegraph when it comes to where the internet is now. We are looking at a continuous integration and folding of the material world into the network, right? In all its complexity. So what we have here, your phone told your Fitbit, that told your Nest, that told your Sonos, that told me that you owe your wife an apology. 2,000 red roses, only $29.99 for a limited time. So what's happening here is that, and again, this captures very well the relationship between a variety of different sociable objects, which talk to each other without a human interlocutor or mediator between them. And in effect, what is more, the humans here, the person and the person's wife, are integrated in that communicative chain on equal terms with these objects, right? So you have a complete rearrangement of space emerging as an effect. And what is more, crucially, a space populated by sociable objects in effect becomes a space where the agency of their combined data shadows continuously manifests itself, right? So from the perspective of a human, this is a weird new type of space which has not existed before, right? It's a I framed it as anticipatory space because it is able to anticipate human action. It is able to anticipate human agency based on the data shadow that is already assembled somewhere online. So the material setting becomes anticipatory because of the implied sociability of its component objects, allowing them to not only exchange data about their human interlocutor, but also draw on remote data resources and then actuate based on the parameters of that aggregate social memory. So this is exactly this moment where the data shadow is being used to affect a space, in effect, completely rearranging the space, unbeknownst to the human right. So this is outside of the range of agency of the human. And in effect, we have a radical symmetry between humans and things emerging, both online and in the real space. And so these anticipatory spaces start acting themselves as sociable space, right? They start anticipating agency. Or as Sally Apnin and Michael Fisher describe it, an environment to be truly smart must learn from the cumulative data within its realm to understand and guess what likely choices might be for a given agent and then facilitate or enact these on behalf of that agent, right? So to translate this in a simpler language, those predictive behavioral patterns that we talked about in the context of the stack, in the context of social media, appear now in the context of sociable objects as a way for spaces populated by sociable objects to radically change the relationship of humans with spaces. Because suddenly an environment, a smart environment, a smart home, let's say, or a smart room populated by sociable objects communicating in a coherent system with each other and with the cloud, obviously, this sort of environment can understand and guess the likely choices of the human, the likely agency of the human, based on the data shadow, right? Based on the predictive algorithm, the predictive behavioral data that has been gathered already and the algorithm is working on. And then the environment can facilitate and enact something on behalf of that agent, or can enact something, some sort of action which on to which the agent, the human agent, would be on the receiving end, right? So we have, from the perspective of the human, these appear almost like magical spaces suddenly, right? Which act on their own without prompted by the human, right? Why? Because they are anticipatory, and this anticipatory power emerges from the Internet of Things, right? This is where sociable objects are leading to. So, in effect, this again is captured by this cartoon, the aggregate power of these data shadows that are being accumulated about a specific space or about a specific human appear as they return back to that space or to that human as agency enacted by sociable objects or acting alone or in tandem to create smart spaces, anticipatory spaces, right? So in effect, you have this sort of situations. Having listened to everything you say for the last year, I have concluded that you are very dull, right? So you have the data shadow returning here. So let's summarize. We have the appearance of anticipatory materiality on top of everything else. And anticipatory materiality is described as spaces constructed with sociable objects which gain agency and predictive power. This transition of spaces from heretofore passive, dull, trivial materiality into anticipatory materiality is part of this dramatic shift caused by the arrival of the Internet of Things, caused by the emergence of an Internet of Things paradigm. So we have a change in the status of objects into sociable objects, change in the status of spaces into anticipatory spaces, and a dramatic ontological equality emerging between humans and these new type of objects, these new type of spaces. So to summarize the map that has emerged so far, we have the Internet of Things paradigm, consisting of objects connecting to the internet, becoming context aware, beaming continuously online their location, identity and state, self-disclosing this context relentlessly. From the perspective of the internet, this data is the object itself, right? So the contextual data is the object, contextual data is the material element, not the other way around. This allows precise mapping of materiality. Furthermore, the human body itself and each and every material element is first and foremost data from the perspective of this paradigm. Everyday objects become sociable and can act in the world based on data shadows. And we have the emergence as an effect of anticipatory spaces, which are able to anticipate actions, anticipate agency, and act based on these anticipations. This is it from me on the context of the Internet of Things. If you have any questions, please hit me up on Twitter @TedMitu. Thank you all for listening and see you online.